of Roller TV, right here on Time Warner Channel number 72. I'm Stephen A. Turner, joined by Mr. Brandon Ward,
Gorilla Style,
and Mr. David Clark,
live and in your living room.
Yeah, we're coming to you from Channel 72 tonight, Time Warner, at the 2420 studios here. We're recording for the first time for TV. Can't wait to get into it. Got a big football season lined up. We're going to go over all the week one games. We got some previews also for OHS, Owensboro Catholic, Davis County, and Hancock County, joined by all the coaches. We'll get into that a little later on. We're going to go ahead and jump into some week one matchups, go ahead and preview them all for you, give you a little information on some teams. If you're not aware of some of the outside teams, we got a little bit of information on them, give you some predictions. Jump right into things. Our good friends down in Meade County, big supporters of the Homer Show. We always follow them. Let's jump in the bus and drive down to Meade County, where Meade County will be playing host to Louisville Butler on Friday night. It's a big 6A matchup. Louisville Butler went 9-3 a year ago. Third-round playoff loss to Ballard, 14-7. Coach Gary Wheeler always fields a good team up at Butler. Meade, on the other hand, Gary Mofield, another great coach. 11-3 last year, deep playoff run. 2 years ago, should have won state, kind of got robbed at the state championship game. It's a big 6A matchup to kick things off here.
It is. And consistency is the key for Meade County. I think that, you know, he's running a tight ship down there, a very consistent ship. And you know that those kids are going to give you 110%. You know, Butler has had a fantastic running back. His name escapes me right now. But I like the way that Meade County, with them being at home, ready to play, first game Friday night, taking a green wave, baby.
I'm going to play the devil's advocate. I'm going to play the role of the bad guy. I've got to roll with Louisville Butler. Meade lost a lot. They struggled in the scrimmage versus DeSales. I know they got crushed by 2A DeSales, which DeSales is a 2A powerhouse. They're still trying to find their identity in Meade County. I think this is a tough one to get out of the gate with. I think Butler's pretty tough. I'll take Louisville Butler 28-14. And the Green Waves will be okay. I just think it's a tough way to start the season.
I got 14-7. I guess I better clarify the score there.
Yeah, there you go. It's okay. It's week one. We haven't been through training camp.
Yeah, I'll go with Meade County because there's one thing I've learned from doing this show is never bet against the Green Wave.
We kind of did in the playoffs last year, and it came back to bite us week after week. I've not learned my lesson. You guys have. Let's move on to McLean County down at the Cougar Car Wash on a Friday night in McLean County, where the Cougars will play host to the Breckenridge County Tigers. Breckenridge County is looking to have a strong showing in basketball, but hey, this isn't November. It is August, and we're getting to week one here. Breckenridge County struggled a little bit on the gridiron. They're a 4A team, only won one game a year ago, lost a tough first-round matchup to OHS. Coach Hoddle down there in Breck County, though, doing some good things in scrimmage. I've been hearing little rumblings about him on Twitter saying, don't sleep on us. We're going to be better this year. They're playing, going on the road to play McLean County 5-5 last year. Just barely missed the playoffs in a heartbreaker. Coach Wagner, phenomenal job over there. They lost some pieces. Austin Gross, all-state running back, gone from the team. But I still like McLean County.
You can sense the excitement in Calhoun right now. I think that from the turnout from the scrimmage at Apollo last week, the McLean County faithful are definitely excited. I think there's a sense of community pride. You know, there's a sense of optimism. You know that Friday night's coming around, and by golly, we got a chance to win the game. And speaking of chance to win the game, I like McLean County at home 49-14.
I'm glad you brought that up. We interviewed Coach Steve Barker last year when he first came from McLean over to Apollo. He said at McLean County that he wanted to change the culture. He wanted fans to stop high-fiving over getting beat by Muhlenberg County and whatnot, by 2 or 3 points, taking that as a win. A loss is a loss, and he wanted people to understand that. And I feel like Coach Wagner is doing the same thing in football. It's not acceptable to lose game by 7 or 3 anymore. You've got to win games, and Wagner's right there now. He's built this program back up from a winless program, and now they're right on the cusp of the playoffs. I believe this is his year. I think they're going to start the season off big. I think they roll versus Breckenridge County 20-12. I don't think it's really as close as that score indicates.
We talked about it all last year throughout football season. We thought Coach Wagner was changing the culture there, and you can see that just in the response that McLean County Post get on our social media networks. Oh. I mean, it's crazy.
And we're going down to Butler County, where the Bear come over the mountain to see Logan County waiting for them.
Will they see a win?
Will they see a win? What's happening?
Will they see a win when they get over the mountain?
I don't know. We're going to get into it. I was
baffled.
I was like, I don't know.
They're going to see a massive win, like a huge win.
I think they will see a win. They saw a win last year, 41-0 in the season opener. Logan County did not win a game last year. Butler County, I like them a lot. They won 7 games last year. Returned star quarterback Rex Henderson. I'm a big fan of his. I think they're going to roll. What do you got?
I like Butler County 42-7, and I think Logan County only scores the 7 when the JV and freshmen are in there.
I agree. I Butler County big. Whooping in this game, 50-7. Butler County gets off on the right foot. I expect really big things out of Butler County this year. But we'll move it up now to a team that struggled a little bit with role reversal. Ohio County going 0-10 last year. The Eagles are looking for a much better season. They're going to play host to Callaway County in a winnable contest. Ohio County went 0-10 last year. Only have 9 seniors. They're a very young group. Coach Ashby, we saw him in a scrimmage versus Catholic. I say scrimmage, 7-on-7 versus Catholic. I think they're heading in the right direction. I think they got some pieces.
Yeah, I thought they were doing some good things, and hopefully that'll carry over to the first game. I don't know anything about what they did in the scrimmage portion of the season, didn't hear anything at all, but I think this is good scheduling. Callaway County's a program that's been down the last couple of years. They got a new coach. They tried to run the spread. It's not been really working, so it's an opportunity at home for Ohio County to make some noise, but unfortunately, I got to be the Debbie Downer here. That I got Callaway winning 28-7.
Callaway went 3-8 a year ago. They lost in the playoffs 38-0 to a Warren East team that I didn't think was very good. New coach Mickey Garrison. I like Ohio County in this one. I think the Eagles almost got a win in the week one last season, and it just spiraled downhill after they couldn't come away with it. I'll take Ohio County 14, Callaway 7.
I was impressed from what I've seen from Ohio County at the game against the Aces. I mean, they shut that high-powered offense down for a couple possessions, even got a turnover or two. So, I mean,
sure.
That when you're coming off of a season where you get 0 wins, I mean, that's pretty good accomplishment right off the bat.
You're looking for anything you can build on, and I think Ohio County will get it jump-started and going back a little bit in the right direction this season. We'll move it on now to Hancock County, where we will be on Friday night doing our first ever live tailgate show in Hancock County as the Hornets 2A play host to 5A Grayson County Cougars, coming off a fantastic year. Both schools gutted by graduation. Really, all the leaders from both squads have graduated. Grayson County did win the season opener a year ago, 23-0. All bets are off in this one. I'm not real sure what to expect because you got two pretty much brand new rosters going head to head. What do you think, Clark?
I'm going to err to the side of the bigger school in this one because, I mean, if you look at the game straight on paper, it's almost one of those things where you don't want to make a prediction because it just seems so close. But I'm going to err to the side of the 5A school, the bigger school, and that's Grayson County. And I'm going to go 14-7 in a tough, hard-fought, fun first Friday night at Schaefer Glover Field.
Be in front of Big Red Nation out there, Hornet Pride, though, at home. They got extra adrenaline going there. So, I mean, don't sleep on the Hornets.
Yeah, we got to go over there. I mean, the Hornet Nation is rabid. We've got to physically be there, so let's try not to all pick against Hancock County. Hancock has a new brand new.
They're pretty rowdy down there in Hancock County. Ask me.
Brand new coach Bob Eubanks is coming to town, bringing the match game with him. He's trying to put things together down there. Take it away, Clark.
Welcome to Schaefer Glover Field at Hancock County High School, where we also have great football and a new car.
Wow, nice. All right. And they're looking for a win. That's what we're looking for. They graduated most everybody. Eubanks is in charge now. Out is Coach Morris. On the flip side, Ed Smart's been there at Grayson County for a while. He's got his offense in place, defense in place. Everybody knows what to expect from an Ed Smart ran football team. I like Grayson County with you. I think 5A versus 2A is the difference here. The numbers game is what I'm going to get into. I think Grayson County, at the end of the day, gets the win. 27, I'll say Hancock 18.
Should be a heck of a game. Yeah, I'm with you, man.
We actually got to catch up to Hancock County coach, Mr. Bob Eubanks. Not the host of the Newlyweds game like we went to play along with, but brand new head coach, Mr. Bob Eubanks. Let's hear from him now.
Hey, Jason Dill with the Homers. I'm here with Hancock County High School coach, Bob Eubanks. Great to have you, coach.
Thanks, Jason. Glad to be here.
Just got a couple quick questions for you. 2014 Hancock County Hornets were led by a great group of seniors. Bo Case, Court Morris, Trevor Garrison, Michael Vaith, to name a few. Who are some guys you're looking to step up and try to fill their shoes?
We got a good group of seniors coming back. Ethan Powers, Walker Hoheimer, Garrett Hedden, Justin Smith, Keaton McCollum. I mean, I could go on and on. Clay Herndon. Those guys, you know, all seniors are looking to step up and, you know, and be leaders on our team. And, you know, most of them are all linemen. We know we got a good group coming back, so we're going to, you know, put it behind them and take off.
Sounds great. Sounds like you got a great group of guys coming back, Coach. and the Homers have noticed that the Hornet fan base is one of the best, if not the best, you know, that we've ever seen. What does their support mean to you and the team as well?
Well, you know, being from here, playing here, it means the world to us. You know, it's one of those things that, you know, you don't have every place. You know, the community supports. We have one high school in the county. The community supports everything we do. And it's just something that, you know, we really rally behind. And anytime you get the support of the community, you know, it really makes our kids feel good. And, you know, and it's, you know, they go to the up to Bills on the Hill. And, you know, the first thing they're doing is asking, hey, what about the game? What about the team? What about the game? You know, that, you know, so it's inbred in the community. And, when, you know, we're excited for it, you know, excited for this season, you know, and excited to put something out here that everybody can be proud of.
I know personally, I've lived in Hancock County for about a year now, and I got to say Hornet pride is pretty impressive. It's everywhere you go. I mean, it's everywhere. I heard about it. Of course, growing up in Owensboro, I didn't see it a lot, but, you know, now that I'm here, it's definitely evident that it's really, really thick up this way. Okay, and what are some of the goals that you have set for this team for the 2015 season?
Well, you know, one of the things was, you know, when I took the job was to get everybody on the same page, you know, and get everybody believing in the common mission, a common vision, and, you know, getting everybody on board. And once we were able to do that, you know, we got kids on board, and, you know, it just kind of, you know, took off. And, you know, one of our main goals is to, you know, of course, have a winning season, you know. And, you know, so a lot of times as a new coach, you come in and you don't really know what's going to happen. But, you know, I've been an assistant here for 5 years. I've known these kids, you know, for that long a time. And, you know, we have some goals, you know, of course, a winning season, you know, when we want to be fighting for 1-2 in the district. And, you know, those are some things that we want to start off with, you know.
Sounds awesome. I could, you know, to say for myself, and I'm sure the rest of the Homers, that, you know, we love some Hancock County Hornet football. And I can say, sitting here watching you guys practice for a few minutes, definitely got me hyped for the season. It's just right around the corner. Coach, we wish you best of luck, and thanks for joining us, bud.
All right, man. Thank you. I appreciate everything you guys do for us and for sports all around the area.
It's great. It's what we do it for. We love it.
Got to thank our guy Jason Deal out there in Hancock County. He's a loyal Owensboro fan, but been transplanted out to Hancock County, so going to try to get some Hancock County coverage out of them.
Yeah, if you're going to go from one fan base to another, going from Owensboro to Hancock County as far as support-wise, I mean, that's pretty solid. Hancock County's got a very, very good fan base. We'll move it on now to another school with a very good fan base right here in Owensboro, the Owensboro Catholic Aces, led by Coach John Edge and All-State candidate quarterback Ray Zuber, will kick the season off at home, taking on Holy Cross. Holy Cross is a 1A school coached by Todd Krumbacher and went 8-4 in 2014, second-round playoff loss to Russellville. Catholic went 10-3 a year ago and lost to Murray. It's been kind of a thorn in their side the last few years. It's a 1A versus 2A matchup. Catholic is a juggernaut offensively. I like the Aces.
I do too. Catholic's going to have the services of Shamari Morton back and a couple of the other kids that missed the scrimmage. So I look for the offensive firepower and the explosion that we all come to know and love about the Owensboro Catholic to be on full display Friday night. Holy Cross is you know, they're pretty good. They're not bad, but it's kind of hard to say. You know, they got blown out by Russellville in the playoffs, so the measuring stick is I can't get a feel for it. But I like Owensboro Catholic. The way they looked in the scrimmage is crisp and sharp. Execution was on point. I'm going for a big 49-14 win for the Aces on Parrish Avenue.
Yeah, you got Zuber back. You got Garner look fantastic in the scrimmage. Weston Jacobs putting up big numbers on the outside. He's going to be, as far as we know, coming up here, you'll hear, he's going to be the only Ace that goes offense and defensive side of the ball. I look for that to be a factor. I think they're going to come out and they're going to punch Holy Cross right in the mouth. I look for a big number on the scoreboard. I'll take Owensboro Catholic 49, Holy Cross 14. It's easy to forget about defense when you've got that high-powered offense, but when you get in playoffs and whatnot, I think defense well wins. John Mark Borman is a strong piece, though. I mean, the guy already proved it last year. I think if you're going to replace Reed, he was Reed's running mate last year. I think if you're looking for a leader to step right in, I think he's already got a little experience in that. I think they can lean a little bit on John Mark Borman on the defense.
Yeah, dude was getting like 20 tackles himself in games.
Let's talk to Coach John Edge. He gave us some time. We'll preview the season for the Owensboro Catholic Aces. No better man to do it than Edge.
What's up, fans? I'm caught up with Coach John Edge, head coach of the Owensboro Catholic football team out here after summer practice. Coach Ed, how's it going?
Great. How you doing, Steven?
Oh, pretty good. Pretty good. I just want to talk a little bit about the upcoming season. I know there's a lot of excited Catholic fans every year. It's a tradition over here, winning tradition. And I just want to, how's things going in spring summer practice so far?
So far, we've done a lot of 7-on-7s. We've gone against Ohio County twice. Went to a tournament up in Kentucky and didn't do too great in the pool play, but made a huge run in the tournament and did really well. Went 3-4 up there. So I think we're okay. We got a lot better after that, and then we came back, played Ohio County again, and then did the 7-on-7 today against Centennial High School out of Franklin, Kentucky. Did pretty good, and they're a 5A team in Tennessee, and we did a really good job with them. I think the score was 3-3, something like that. So we got better, and that's all we're asking for right now. We're taking it one day at a time, winning one day at a time.
And that's what you got to do early in the season. Let's talk a little bit about your offense. Obviously, it starts with the quarterback, Ray Zuber, Mr. Football Candidate. We saw him last year just light up the scoreboards, touchdown after touchdown. Just talk a little bit about Ray and your offense as a whole.
Good. Well, Ray, he's the more important thing for him this year is we know what he's got fundamentally. There are some things he's going to have to work on. He's going to have to sit in the pocket and make plays. We know he can run around and make plays. That's great. But we've got to have him be a leader as well. That's the most important thing. I think as a junior, we relied on our seniors last year to be leader. Well, he's a senior now, so he's going to have to be more vocal. He's going to have to get on to some kids, he may have to get on to. And that's him. He's going to have to be a leader. And he's done that so far, so, they've responded well, especially, when we did some 7-on-7s up in Kentucky, and, it worked out really well. So I think everybody's responding. We're getting better. The main thing is that our receivers, we got Shamari Morton back. We got Hayden Hartz playing Y. We got Michael Mills playing Z, and we got Weston Jacob, who's been a huge, huge player for us in these 7-on-7s so far. So he's been doing good. He's got to continue to get better. There's still a lot of things he's got to finish because he's also going to play free safety for us. So he's got to get in good shape, and he is. He's in good shape, so he's ready to go. Our offensive line, we got four guys coming back. Luke Reynolds, our center, David Weaver, a guard, Max Maloney, a tackle, and then Isaac Arnold, a tackle. So we got one position left to fill, and we've got a little battle for about three linemen doing that, which is good. More linemen, the merrier, because in that way you can platoon your D-line and offensive line, which we've done. We've gone with a lot of speed on defense, a whole lot of speed on defense. Right now, if we sit down, we've got one kid going both ways, and that's Weston Jacob. So wow. We're very excited about that. That may change. They're going to have to get better, and we're going to have to maybe bite a bullet here and there on the defensive side and just get better. But, we've got to have that going into the playoffs. I think the years we've gone to state, if you looked at senior high, Highlands didn't have anybody going both ways. The teams that we played, Newport Central didn't have anybody going both ways. The years we've done, we were well, we only had the one, kid going both ways. We got to get back to that. And sometimes you're going to have to bite a bullet early on in the season to get better. But then going into defense, we started John Mark Mormon. He's our captain on the defense. He's a linebacker, had over 200 tackles last year. Looking for him to have the same, and he's got to make plays for us. Bailey McKay, another linebacker for us coming back. Nick Blair played a little bit for us last year as a sophomore. He's going to come ready. He's going to be ready to play. Now, coming with our corners, we got Motez Gray, Nolan Elder playing corner for us. And then Weston and Michael Mills are going to be playing some safety for us as well. As outside backers will be Houston Riney wearing the famous number 2 for Owensboro Catholic. And then our D-linemen are going to be Noah Todd, Randall Johnson, and Will Stone. So none of those guys play or are going to be starting offensive line. So that's going to be huge for us. Come down the stretch.
That is big. Anytime you can get conditioning better, especially late in the season, we've seen it the last few years, late in the season, conditioning is huge. So just talk a little bit about your schedule, too. Just run down the list, any major games sticking out. I know last year you had a Saturday game with Modern Day in Illinois. Yeah. I thought that was a cool thing on Saturday afternoon. What games you got standing out for you this year?
This year we play Holy Cross, who's, you know, they're a very powerful 1A team, but they, you know, they got to remember, they, every year they got beat by Mayfield, who now is in 2A now. Right. So, you know, the team they got beat by in the semifinals every year was no slouch. It was a very good, well-skilled football team. And, you know, Holy Cross played them tough. And so I've got some video on them on, you know, in the last year. So they are a very good football team. They're well coached. And that, yeah, that's the most important game on our schedule. I'll go on down the list. You know, you got Davis County, who's got a very good receiver in John Stratton. Their quarterback plays a better. Bouchard's, you know, they, we can go on about them, too. Right. They've got some good linemen. You know, the Reinerson kids are very good linemen. Well, next play, next game is Custis Owensboro.
Obviously, they, that's a city huge, county game.
That's
everybody
a huge
looks
game,
to.
Absolutely. And they got tons of people coming on defense. That's going to be a good matchup for us on the offensive end. And, you know, offensively, you know, you hear rumors they're playing a different offense, you know, but you never know. They'll line up and they'll get back in their veer if they have to. You know, they'll do that. They've got the weapons and the athletes to do that, and they can do that. You know, the game after that is South Spencer. They've got some kids coming back as well. I mean, we're fortunate to beat them last year with a huge score, but, you know, that's one game they always circle on this schedule. They got a lot of pride against the Indiana and Kentucky team. So they, you know, when they cross that bridge, you know, on that game on Friday, September 11th, I believe, they're gonna come in with a lot of vengeance and ready to go. The next game is Apollo. Apollo will be a lot better, especially on the defensive side of the ball. You know, talking to some people that done some 7-on-7s with them, they feel really comfortable with them and think that they're, you know, getting better. And I, you know, I've talked to Dan a lot in the off season. You know, one thing he's done, he's got a strength coach, done a lot of stuff.
Absolutely.
With them. So that's huge. So I'm looking for a lot of big things out of them. And then, you know, week five, that's going to be difficult. They'll have a lot of film on us, so they're gonna be a lot better. And then after that, we start our district. We'll start out with Butler County, and then Hancock, McLean, and then Todd. And then our last game of the season is against North Hardin, 6A North Hardin. We love a game like that before
right for a playoff.
It helps us. You know, win or lose, we're going to get better. And we got to see that type of speed. Before we play a Mayfield, a Murray, a, you know, the Sales, depending on how far we go, and we're going to see that type of team when we play them.
Yeah, 2A is absolutely loaded. You guys are you guys
west,
right in the mix there,
yeah,
too, but in the west side,
the west is
it's the best side.
Yeah, a little rough there.
Yeah.
You know, the west is definitely, I mean, if you look at the top 10, I mean, you've got 7-8 teams in the West that are in the top 10, and that's no joke. I mean, you know, the West side's loaded. Whoever comes out of there, you know, in the West has got a good shot. I mean,
they'll be battle tested.
They'll be definitely battle tested.
Yeah.
From second round, first round, second round, third round, you know, first round on. That whole playoff, they're going to be battle tested really well. And, you know, Newport will be Newport. They're very good. They're very well coached. They've got a huge metro area to get their kids from and everything. So they will be good too. They're going to play a tough schedule. They're going to play the Riles. They're going to play Highlands. They're going to play Beachwoods. They are going to get battle tested too early on, and you know, in the season. So don't think for a minute that they're not worthy just because they're ranked, you know, fifth or sixth. You know, we're not ranked until lower part of the top 10, so that's good. I'm not worried about rankings.
No, rankings don't mean anything.
I don't care about rankings because here's the thing, great thing about high school football, you play a playoff system. So, you know, you can rank us down at the bottom if you want to. We'll play the best team and go from there.
That's right. At the end of the day, who gets the win, that matters much
that's
more.
Right. That's
much
right.
More than the ranking. I appreciate you giving us some time out here. I know Catholic fans are excited. It's an exciting time of year, and we're ready to get back on the gridiron. Coach, thank you for giving us a few minutes.
Thanks, Stephen.
Thank you.
Big thanks to Coach Ash for giving us some time. I know it's really busy summer practice and whatnot, getting prepared for the season. So big thanks to him for coming on to the show. We're going to move it on now to a team across town, the Davis County Panthers. They take the road trip down to Allen County, Scottsville. Allen County, coached by Bradley Hood, went 4-7 in 2014, lost the playoff matchup in the first round to Madisonville, 4A school. So Davis County, these two teams didn't play last year. We've talked about Davis County at length on the podcast. Davis County is loaded with talent.
Yeah, it's no secret that the offensive weapons, we've mentioned them 100 times, Stratton, Spicen, LaCroix, Bouchard. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. But the big question for me for the Panthers is the defense. You know, I like Davis County in this game on the road, first game of the year, to win 42-21. But if I'm a Panther fan, if I'm a diehard D.C. Panther, I want to see that 21 be 7 or 14.
Sure.
You know what I mean? Just because I think they're the prohibitive favorite in this game, I want to kind of see them go out and put their stamp on the football field and say, hey, you know what? We're not going to allow this team to score 21 points.
That's something they're not used to yet, is being a prohibitive favorite going into the game. So you want to see how they respond to that.
Absolutely. I think they did very good in the scrimmage versus John Harden. It kind of turned my head. 21-21 versus a very good program in John Harden. This is a team I've kind of taken a liking to, just because talent across the board is just flat nasty. I mean,
got possibly the best quarterback in the region, and he might not even be your starter.
May not even be the starter. McElwain is in the challenge there with Bouchard, and I fully expect Bouchard to win the job. We'll see. Stratton, 6'5 wide receiver, maybe the best wide receiver in this area as far as size, footwork, being able to go up and get the ball that I've seen. I mean, he's just.
I think clearly he's the most recruitable.
Yeah.
You 6'5 and athletic.
High ceiling.
You can't. I mean, that you can't put a price tag on that kind of ability.
You've returned LaCroix and Spicen running the ball. Now, offensive line's a little bit of a question, but if they can patch that, I mean, there's weapons all over this offense. Look for them to try to run the ball, but it all comes down at the end of the day to defense and to see if their defense can be a little bit better.
And something that they're planning on doing is running the ball a lot more. So, I mean, that's going to keep the defense off the field. Kind of look at Dallas Cowboys last year.
Yeah,
it's
sure.
A good way to do it if you're not sure about your defense is try to keep them off the field.
I mean, they were already pushing the ball down the field very well last year. I feel like if they could run the ball at
more. Control the clock.
Try to run it more, control the clock, right. And it opens up the pass even more. So it could be even more opportunities for Stratton and Bouchard to hook up down the field. But I'm also going to roll with DC 42-14 in this one. I think they win big. And I don't think there's really much trouble on the road for Davis County. Just go ahead and take the next step. Try to make this an elite program for 2015. And who better to talk about it than Coach Matt Brannon? He joined me and talked a little bit, broke down his roster a little bit, talked a little bit about the 2015 season.
Steve Turner here with the Homers. Out here with brand new Davis County football coach Matt Brannon. Matt, thanks for joining us.
Hey, thanks for being out here. Thanks for the coverage you guys bring to high school sports. It's a pleasure listening to you guys, and glad you're out here.
We have a blast with it, and I love that all the high school coaches have been great, giving us great access. We appreciate the time, but take us back a little bit. Brand new coach, a hiring process, how that went. You're assistant here, and now I know the players loved it. They loved the hire. And talk a little bit about going from an assistant to now being the head coach.
I think being here for as long as I have was an easy transition. You know, I had a relationship built with the players, and you know, it was unfortunate the way it worked out for the former head coach, but I was you know, glad to get the opportunity. I've been working my career preparing to become a head coach. So, you know, I've been thinking about what I would do, how I would run my program, and I was fortunate to have some leadership as a defensive coordinator. So it was an easy transition for me, especially being in a familiar place. So, you know, I'm excited to be out here, that's for sure. So.
Awesome. I know you got a lot of weapons coming back. We talked a little bit off the air about you're going to run the offense now. I know a lot of hype around quarterback Bouchard. You got Stratton, who's one of our favorite players from last year, one of the best wide receivers at the high school level in this area that I've ever seen. Size, footwork, and everything. Just talk a little bit about your offense.
Yeah, we had a very dynamic offense last year. We were big hitters. You know, and I felt like that was something that we needed to work on was controlling the clock a little bit because we were such a quick strike offense. You know, we were able to put up points, but we needed to burn some clock and give our defense time to rest.
Sure.
And so we've got to be able to run the ball, move the sticks a little bit. You know, we've had a great battle at quarterback. Bashar's a great quarterback. He got in last year off of an injury from Jerry McEwen, and he's really pushed him. So, you know, I feel like we're strong at that position. You know, they're still battling. They will be until week one and beyond.
Okay.
So, and besides the battle there, whoever's not at quarterback is playing receiver, and both of them are doing a fantastic job there. And then obviously with John, you know, he's the hardest worker on the team, hardest worker in the weight room, and, you know, he's got a lot of skill too, so it shows on the field. you know, we're hoping that we can see him play somewhere at the next level.
Absolutely. I don't have any doubt about that.
So, you know, and that's been exciting going through that recruiting process, being able to talk to college coaches and things like that. But, you know, we've got the running backs and we've got the big boys up front that we hope to be able to push some people around this year. You know, we really emphasize that. A receiver like Stratton, you know, we can use him in a tight end sets. We can use him split out. And so we're able to create better creases with, you know, with our run game with some tight end sets. So, you know, that's kind of the focus that we're going into. You know, we want to establish the run game. And then it's going to open up the big plays for us. So.
Absolutely, yeah. And on the defensive side of the ball, I know Reinerson returns, and your defense should be much better this year. I look for big things out of your defense this year.
Yeah, we're really excited. You know, we're really solid up front with Reinerson. You know, we've got Samuel Spicen, who we've moved down to linebacker, who's made an impact right away with his speed and his physicality. He's all over the field. You know, probably our leader on the defense is Jordan Lee. He's a quiet kid, but man, he plays loud. You know, he's all over the place. He understands all the checks. He gets everybody in the right positions. And then, you know, I've gone out and I've recruited a little bit, and I've got two baseball players.
That's what I heard.
The Powell twins, who are have taken over starting safeties for us. So we've got some speed back there as well. And then there are two corners. Gage Long, who is a senior as well, that has worked his way into starting lineup and has been a great leader for us. And then somebody I think you're going to watch for is Alec Payne, number four. He's a junior. He's coming off. He's a dynamic athlete. Not many people know about him. I think he's going to make some big plays for us.
So. We always like to hear about the new impact players, so to speak. So get into your schedule a little bit. I know you got the city-county games, which is always fun, and you're in the 6A, the only 6A team in the city. Talk a little bit about some of the highlight games along the way on your schedule.
Well, we open up with Allen County on the road, be able to go down there and go against Coach Bradley Hood, who's from this area, played at Ohio County and McLean County. So we're excited about that. We feel like that's a good opening game for us. They're a strong 4A program.
Yeah,
so, you know, it's going to give us a really good test. Then we get to come back to Catholic and get our first taste of the city. So, you know, we're looking, you know, our goals are lofty. Our expectations are high. You know, we've never played in a regional championship game here. So that's one of our goals, is to get to the third round of the playoffs. And, you know, we feel like if in our class of 6A through Henderson and McCracken County, if we can get to a 6A regional championship game, then we're good enough to go, you know, to the end. So that's definitely a goal for us. And then competing in the city is huge. You know, we want to have some bragging rights around here. You know, we're looking to turn things around, and by doing that, we've got to have some success here locally. So. You know, it goes a long way for trash talking in the offseason.
Oh, absolutely.
As well, so.
Yeah. And I'm telling you right now, we follow it a lot. You guys have just as much talent as anybody in town across the board. Davis County may not have always been there name-wise as far as tradition-wise for football. I think you could turn that around. This class right here is strong, and we're really looking for big things out of you guys this year.
I'm definitely fortunate. I think we've got 28 seniors to come into a class like that. You know, several of those kids that were – when they were freshmen were playing. So, you know, I've got four or five players that have 4 years playing experience, which doesn't happen a lot in high school football, especially in 6A, you know,
sure.
For a large program. So we're excited, you know, and the expectations are high. You know, that's the thing, is that if we want to change the perception, then it's got to start with themselves. It's got to start with what we do out here on a daily basis. So
yeah, and we saw you working just a while ago. We actually came out to the 7-on-7s. You got a good looking team, Coach. We're looking forward to covering you. Thank you for giving us time.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Davis County's got high expectations. We'll see if they can put it together. He pretty much summed up the team better than any of us could.
We talked about McLean County changing the culture. He's trying to change the culture himself right there at DC.
Yeah,
I'm a believer. I just need to see it on the field. I believe. I'm excited. You know, especially as a guy who's not a Davis County fan. Can't wait.
Everything we said that we would do at Davis County throughout the offseason and last year's season, he pretty much nailed in that interview. Right.
Yeah,
there.
I came away impressed from the interview. It kind of built my expectations higher for them, and then the scrimmage with John Harden kind of just solidified that. And now we just got to see it real, you know, in real action.
I actually told Clark after we did that interview, I was like, new coach Brennan either gets it where he listens to the homers a lot because he nailed everything that we said.
Talked about. Yeah, you're right. You're right. We'll move it on now across town to Apollo, where Apollo will host Muhlenberg County on Friday night. These two teams did not play last season. Both teams struggled a little bit last year. Muhlenberg County got off to a pretty good start, but they lost seven out of the last eight. Lost the first-round playoff game to Bryan Station. And Coach Hayes Browning's looking to build on the early season success, maybe carry that over to this season. Apollo went 2-8 a year ago, lost in the first round to Bowling Green. Their only two wins came against teams that did not have a win. They had a really rough season last year, looking to get things going in the right direction there. I don't really know how this one goes. It's going to be a good game right off the bat for both teams to set the tone for the season, try to get things going in the right direction.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think these two teams are about as evenly matched as you could possibly be. I think the talent level is pretty comparative between the both of the teams. I think Apollo at home has a real good chance to get the season started off on the right foot. And I think if they can do that, you know, it could set the tone for good things to come later on in the season. I know there's some question marks defensively about what Apollo can do on that side of the ball, but there's one thing that there's certainly not a question mark, and that's the ability of Rates Lewis. And if I'm Apollo, I mean, you know, you don't ever want to overuse a kid, become too obvious, you know, but definitely want to get that kid as many touches in the open field that you could possibly get, because the kid's a threat to take it to the house anytime he touches
sure,
the ball.
Sure, absolutely.
And then if he does that, it's going to open up your run game a lot more.
What I'm looking for is the defensive side of the ball. I have a lot of faith in Rates, and I think they've got some good quarterbacks over there, Rasko and Alexander, but I think Alexander's going to get the start. But I think both quarterbacks can throw the ball. I think they're both capable of being very decent quarterbacks. So what I look for is the defense. They really struggled on defense to stop anybody last year. They put up most every team they played put up a big number against them. They've got to improve in that area. Coach Matthews, the strength coach, Coach Edge talked about it from Catholic. He's adding a lot to that program, period. I mean, not just football, but we've already seen it pay dividends in baseball. I mean, baseball team was much stronger this year, I thought. And so now I'm looking to him, and I think he's going to help build him up front, maybe not get pushed around so much. Matthews is going to make a difference. We'll see if it makes enough difference. I don't know. This first game's up in there. What do you got?
Yeah, unfortunately, I'm going to have to go with Muhlenberg coming out with the win, 28-21. But I think, if you know, win or lose, Apollo just needs to have a very good, solid showing, solid effort, so that they're just not crushed the first game of the season.
Sure, I don't think they will. I don't think Muhlenberg is that far. You know, I think both these teams are right there together.
Apollo could win this game.
Oh, yeah.
Let me be clear about that. I mean, this is a toss-up.
It's week one. We don't know what
to
expect.
This is actually Team 10 and Team 9, and David Clark's top 10.
Sure.
So, I mean, right off the gate.
Absolutely. You know, I'm looking for Apollo's offense to flow a little better than their defense. Muhlenberg, I think, just has a little bit more weapons on athlete. Kobe Drake and company. They're tough. I mean, you know, Rates is also tough. I think it's going to be really close. At the end of the day, I'm going to have to roll with Muhlenberg, 21-20. I think it's going to be a tight affair. It's going to come right down to the wire. The team that makes the play in the fourth quarter is the team that wins, and I think that team can build on some success moving forward.
I'm picking Apollo on this one. I think they're coming out with a chip on their shoulder.
I'm back and forth, to be honest with you. All day long thinking about doing the predictions, I've been back and forth. Finally said about Muhlenberg just for the simple fact that I like their athletes just a little bit better than Apollo. We'll see. Could be wrong. Now let's move it on now to the team that had the most success of anybody in town last year, the team that maybe has the highest expectations of any team in town coming in. The Owensboro Red Devils will travel down to where the season ended a year ago at the Hilltopper Stadium. That's where they're going to want to end it again, as they're going to be going on the road to take on Warren Central, the Dragons. We'll see. This is a rematch. They played last year on October the 3rd. Owensboro won that game 28-26 on a failed two-point conversion from Warren Central. Warren Central, predominantly good program, went 6-5 last year, lost in the first round to Christian County. We all know Owensboro, state runners-up, probably could have been state champion just on the doorstep. Right on the doorstep. Out is Coach Prince. He left a very great tradition there at Owensboro and moved out to North Carolina. Is that right?
Virginia. Fauquier High School.
Yeah, and
glad you said that.
That's
on TV.
Wrong,
yeah, that's right there on
the edge. No, you said it right, but it's a dangerous way to say the word.
That's right.
It is, and in is new coach Jay Fallon. Out is quarterback Nick Locker. In quarterback Mr. Gross. We'll see. I mean, you got to have to show me something, but they have a lot of good nucleus coming back. I really like what I see from Owensboro early.
I put zero stock into what happened in this game last year. Last year's game was on that freak windstorm, like it was cold and it was windy. Nick Locker punts the ball, goes back 15 yards. So I think this game is a brand-new game, brand-new coaches, LT Smith Stadium, Western Kentucky University. The one thing Warren Central has is they will have the athletes to match up with Owensboro. Owensboro will not be able to step onto the turf out there and overwhelm them. But I still like the experience. 9 of 11 starters back. The nucleus, the core, the skill guys are back. Zach Gross throws for 4 touchdowns in a scrimmage last week. So I'll take it. Owensboro, a hard-fought game, 21-14, but it would not surprise me if Owensboro blew this thing open.
And you also got to think they're going to step on the field at Western Kentucky, and they're going to remember that the last game they played there, and they're going to play a little bit angry.
Yeah, I'm a little worried about the quarterback position just for the simple fact of the inexperience at the quarterback position. Maybe a new offense as well. I do think the weapons are there to prop up the quarterback. I think T.J. James, the running back, one of the better running backs around, and you got your little bear on the outside, two guys that can prop up a quarterback. I mean, all you have to do is throw the ball maybe on a 5 or 6 yard out pattern, and Joel Barrett could house it at any moment. And T.J. James, look for him to have a big one in this one, maybe 3-4 touchdowns out of T.J. I think Owensboro comes out firing. I look for him to put a lot of points on the board. 35-21, I'll take the Devils to get the season started off right. But we caught up with Coach Jay Fallon. He's going to run down what he thinks he's got coming up for the season. He's going to run down his offense, defense, schedule, and whatnot, and give us a little more insight into the Devils for 2015.
Steve Turner here with the Homers, out here with brand-new Owensboro football coach, Jay Fallon. Coach, thanks for joining us.
Absolutely. Glad to have you guys out here. Thanks for coming out.
Talk a little bit. Take us back a little bit to the beginning. You got hired over back in the spring.
Mm-hmm.
Take us through the process, maybe back then, how that hiring process came along for you, and then the transition from becoming assistant to the head coach of one of the most prestigious football programs in the whole nation, really.
Absolutely. We found out, we kind of knew that Coach Prince was sort of ready to retire and be closer to his family, even at the end of the season last season. We found out in January that he had taken another job with Fauquier High School in Virginia. And sort of, at the beginning, we just kind of talked about it as a staff. Where are we going to go from here? How are we going to, what's going to happen if somebody new comes in? And we all sort of knew that we had something special here. Not just because of last year, but just because this group of coaches, and I honestly believe this, and I tell everybody this, there's not a better group of coaches in the state of Kentucky than the guys that coach here. And we knew we had an awesome group of kids returning and a chance to be really special. And I really wanted to keep that going and have an opportunity like this. I thought about it a lot. I gave it a lot of thought, and I felt like at the end of the day that I wanted to give it a shot. Applied, interviewed, and was fortunate enough to get the job. In March 1st, was named head coach.
Awesome. And a little bit different out here running the practice as the head coach.
Absolutely. It's much different. And I was fortunate enough to learn from a great mentor like Joe.
Absolutely.
Not only a great coach, but a close personal friend of mine. Just a great guy. We still talk every week, twice a week sometimes. We talk about his program. He still loves Owensboro. How's it going? How the guys doing? How's Tavian doing? How's TJ doing? Blessed to have learned from him. But yeah, it's been a process, but I have the support, like I said, of a great group of guys in the coach's office and a great group of kids that have made the transition much easier.
Talk a little bit about your offense. Obviously, the big question is replacing Nick Locker at quarterback on the offensive side of the ball. Just talk a little bit about some of the guys that are standing out early in the summer here and who you're looking for to be the new leader, because losing Locker, that's a leader at quarterback position.
Sure. We graduated a huge class of seniors, not just Nick. But Nick is going to be a tough one to replace. A lot of guys have stepped up and done a great job for us. T.J. James, in my opinion, is going to be one of the best running backs in the state. And then you got weapons all around him. Jaleel Barrett, Keyshawn Walker, Jacoby Gardner, Tavian Board, Rayshawn Washington. And if I'm leaving anybody out, it's my error, but we've got weapons all over the field. We've got a big line up front. We returned Lucas Williams, who I think will be one of the better tackles in this area, if not in the state. And Zach Gross has stepped up and done a nice job for us at quarterback. Really pleased with the way he performed in some of the 7-on-7s this summer. He's done a nice job growing into that leadership role for us.
Yeah, he won the job, so that's already off to a good start, good competition. Talk about your defense. I'm a big fan of your defense. I've been telling everybody that defense is going to be flat and nasty. You do have to replace Arius Phillips on the backside. A great, great player, but I expect big things out of this defense.
Oh, yeah. In terms of leadership and maturity, Arias is he's a once-in-a-lifetime kind of kid. But we returned 9 out of 11 off a defense that went to the state championship. We're very excited about that unit. You know, up front, we've got Vasad Greer, Trey Crow, Quamari Tinsley are doing a great job. At the linebacker position, Tavian Board, Malik Mundy, Jacoby Gardner, Quadri Tinsley. We got a host of linebackers. Chris Bardemus doing a great job. TJ is stepping up and playing a lot of safety for us. Matt Bardemus at the corner. We've got Jaleel and Keyshawn. We've got guys that have been playing since they were sophomores. They understand the defense. They understand how to play defense. We expect big things from that side of the football.
Oh, yeah, a lot of experience on that side of the ball. That adds to the expectations. Talk a little bit about your schedule. Obviously, you look down the list, and it's the who's who. I mean, you got a big schedule. 5A's loaded. You got Highlands and Bowling Green in there, the top dogs, obviously, and you guys are right there in the mix. Just talk a little bit, run down your schedule, some highlight some games there,
sure,
and some games that stand out.
Sure. You know, with realignment, we moved to 5A, so the schedule is almost completely different. Outside of the city-county games, and we maintain the rivalry with Madisonville, we're now in district with Christian County, who's perennially great, Graves County, who was 7 points away from a state title, just like us. In-city, we'll be in district with Apollo. That's back to a district matchup for us now. On the other side of the district, you've got Bowling Green, and, of course, in 5A, on the other side of the state, Highlands and Pulaski County, who won 5A last year. So it's a loaded class.
Sure is.
But we feel like we can compete. And if things go well, if things break well for us, we stay healthy, we continue to progress the way we have, we feel like we've got a chance to make a run.
Yeah, obviously, lastly, talk about your goals. I mean, I'd say state championships probably the ultimate goal. Any small goals or anything you're looking for early in the season, maybe?
Well, in terms of, you know, our goals on down the line, our goal right now is to take it one day at a time, try to get a little bit better every day and every game. We can't get focused on trying to win a state championship right now, but, you know, little goals, you know, get ready. And the little goal is come out here every day and try to get better. You know, a lot of people don't realize the football season starts July 13th, and it is a grind of two-a-days, film study, pushing the guys in the weight room, pushing the guys in conditioning. And you got to have a mature bunch of kids to come out here and take advantage of every opportunity to get better. And our kids have really done that. And we want to continue that into the season. How do we come out here and how do we challenge a group of guys that have been playing since they were sophomores to keep getting better every single day?
And lastly, you have a scrimmage coming up Friday night. Is that right? We can tell we're going to be doing the show on Wednesday, so we can let all the people know it's 6:30 here.
We're going to kick off at 6:30. We've gone at 6 historically on that scrimmage. Coach Clark doesn't feel like he can get here in a reasonable amount of time to kick off at 6:30. That's a long trip. At 6, that's a long trip for them, so we pushed it back to 6:30. It's going to be beautiful weather. The high for Friday right now is projected to be like 84. It's going to be beautiful at kickoff time. We expect a big crowd. We're very excited to come out here and hit somebody else for a change.
Sure. Well, thank you for giving us some time.
Absolutely.
Appreciate it. Good luck to you guys this season.
Thanks.
OHS got big-time expectations coming up for this season. I think at the end of the day, I think if the quarterback can come along, I don't necessarily know you can replace Nick Locker, but I think if he could be decent, I think that the defense and the weapons on this team, sky's the limit.
I got one thing to say about Owensboro season. Hashtag fear the Billy. Rashad Greer started it up on
like
Facebook campaign.
I like
Mr. Rashad Greer.
Hey, I fear Rashad Greer.
Best defensive lineman in the state.
I'm going to line up across from him.
I tell you, man, the thing that stood out to me about that interview with Coach Fallon, and we appreciate that interview, is the fact that, you know, yeah, the goal is to win the state championship, but also – you know, the small goals, the day-to-day tasks, the things that you have to do to become a great football team is not overlooked. And I like the fact that he emphasizes, you know, everybody's goal is to win a state championship.
Yeah,
everybody can put on your shoulder pads and help and say,
oh,
we're going to win a state championship. But are you willing to do what it takes to win the state championship? The small things, the film study, the opportunities, the reps, you know, taking advantage, maximizing potential. I like the fact that he breaks it down to that level and that doing those things make a state championship a reality.
I like that he said his biggest challenge was getting players that have played 2 or 3 years to keep getting better, not getting complacent. Don't just because you were good last year, don't get complacent. You got room to get better. That was an awesome point right there. But, I mean, we talked about we got two new coaches. Both of those guys handled those interviews like pros. I was blown away by both of them.
No question. I look at OHS, in closing, I look at OHS as football team, similar to like I looked at their basketball team. I think just talking to the kids, man, just the workman-like attitude, they're locked in. They're focused. Similar thing to what when we talked to the kids in basketball, I mean, they were locked in. They were very dedicated to getting better and knowing they needed to get better and putting the work in and just almost taking it upon themselves to lead themselves to the state championship, and not taking anything away from Coach Drake and the basketball team, but I feel like the kids just really just that mentality. And I see the same similar thing with football. They have a bad taste in their mouth from that state championship game. They're going to be looking to get back there.
That's the biggest thing that separates OHS kids now, that even from when I was in high school. They take it a lot more serious now. There's an attitude. There's an environment of hard work, workmanship, going in, punching in the time card, and looking at it from a business perspective, where back in the day, we were kind of just nonchalant about it. And I think the results showed it. You could see how much better the kids are nowadays about it.
And we talk about it all the time, just from the interaction we get from Owensboro fans. It's like a family there. You never hear any bickering in between them. They're always, I mean, they support guys that played there in 1964, just like they do that play there today. I mean, awesome family atmosphere over there.
No doubt. It shows in all their sports. They're very successful right now in almost every single sport they put on the field or whatever it may be. So we're looking forward to keeping up with Owensboro and all of the schools around the third region this year. Thanks for joining us on our very first ever Homer's TV special right here on Channel 72, Time Warner Cable. Ward, take us out of here.
I want to remind you, you can go to www.homersradio.com. You can follow us at Homer's Radio on Instagram and Twitter. Find the MixLR app where you can listen to all of our live shows and our tailgate show. Speaking of the tailgate show, this Friday, if you're listening to this right now on Channel 72, flip on over to the MixLR app. We'll be bringing you live play-by-play of Hancock County versus Grayson. You can find us also on livesportscaster.com. Gorilla style!